Okay, if you want to connect with H2 in-memory database, we have to add two artifacts. One is a Spring Boot starter data JPA, another one is a H2 artifact, another one is a Spring Boot DevTools. The three artifacts we have to add. Okay. Once we add this artifact, we have to start the server. Whenever you start the server, Spring Boot do auto configuration. Spring Boot do auto configuration for your H2 database. Okay. It will create one random database. If you're not doing any configuration, automatically Spring Boot do one. Automatically Spring Boot create one random database. Through that random database, we can do our DB operation. Okay. I'll stop the server. I'm starting it now. When you look at the console, you can notice that. You can see here H2 console auto configuration. H2 console auto configuration. H2 console available at this path. This path. This path is to access DB client interface. DB client interface. Through this client interface, you can directly work with the database. You can see the database table, everything. This database available at, it's saying JDBC colon H2 colon mem colon. This is the database name. Random database name. It will create one unique number. Okay. Through this path, you can access the database. Okay. If you want to access the H2 console, if you want to access the DB interface, use this URL. Go to browser. Just to paste it. Loclofs 8080 H2 console. Then this screen will come where you have to enter your database name that's showing in the console. Just to copy this, you can copy entire stuff, copy and paste it, then connect. So it's connected. Okay, this DB configuration happened through auto configuration. See here, the application YAML file, I'm not doing anything. All are commented out. I'm not doing anything. All are commented out. Okay, whenever you stop the server, this database get vanished. This database get destroyed. Okay. Now I'll copy this DB information in the notepad. Now I'm going to restart the server. Again, it is generated a new database. See, this name is different, this name is different. So whenever you start the application, the old database get destroyed, data also get destroyed, everything gone. Okay, when you start the application, a new database will create. Okay.
Suresh, one question here. So if it is if the database connection string is generated dynamically, how will connect to the database? So we have to get the ID dynamically, every time.
Every time. If you are not doing configuration, every time you have to get that ID. Otherwise, you can go with your own database name also. That I will show part of manual configuration. Okay.
Okay, so H2 is a database, like I don't know what is JPA here.
H2 is a database. Now,
what is my JPA?
Interact with the H2 database. Not only H2 database, any database take, MySQL, Oracle, anything. Finally, I'm storing my application data in the database, right? Now, I want to do some CRUD operation, do some DB manipulation. Those things I'm not doing directly to database. I'm not connecting directly. Through JPA, I am manipulating in the database. JPA provide non-rich API to perform a query For this operation, JPA provide very rich APIs, flexible APIs. Through that API, we can manipulate your database. That database can be anything, H2 or MySQL, Oracle, anything. Okay. In few minutes, I'm going to show how to interact the database through JPA. Okay.
Okay, Suresh, thank you.
Okay, this is now my manual configuration. Using this property, we can enable the H2 console. H2 DB interface, we can enable through this property. Then JPA. JPA show-sql. The meaning of this property is, whenever you fire a query from your Java program to database, from the Java program to the database, whatever query is firing, that query I want to show inside a console. Okay. If you want to view that query information, you can use this property. When you say true, all the query available here. We can see in the log. DDL auto colon update. That meaning whatever changes happening in your entity object, that changes reflected automatically in your database table. Okay. That changes reflected in your database table. Then data source. Using data source attribute, we can tell that what is the DB you want to connect. This is the DB URL. JDBC colon H2 colon mem. This is the path to access the database. After that, you need to mention DB name. In this case, it's coming some random ID, right? As a DB name. Here you can mention whatever name you want. I'm mentioning here test DB. Then username equal to SC, I'm mentioning password equal to blank. Then driver class name. This is the driver class name to connect with the database. Okay. This is a driver class name coming from H2 library. Through this library, we can connect to the database. This is the configuration to connect with particular database. Okay. Not only for H2, any database if you take, this is the standard configuration we need to follow. Okay. After completion of this example, this crude operation, I will show how to do that in MySQL. Okay. Now, each time when start the application, what will happen? Our customer table get created automatically because of this attribute, DDL auto equal to update, I am saying. When you look at the customer class, I am saying here at entity, at table. At entity means this customer object can map to the database table. This customer class eligible to map to the customer table in the database. Then through this at table annotation, I am saying what table you want to map. I am saying that customer table. The customer table I want to map. Then ID generated value. I am saying at ID at generated value. Through this annotation, I am saying that I want to make this ID as an auto generation. Whenever you create a new row, one ID will create it automatically. Then name, address, fee, total, all database column. For the database column, I am creating one more attribute here. I am mapping that column to particular database. Okay, then I am creating a setter and getter method. That is, this is the way of mapping one Java object to database table. Okay, now when you look at the H2 console, we are using random db. Now I'll go to restart my application. So H2 console, database available at JDBC colon, H2 colon, mem colon, test DB. So, because I mentioned here test DB, it is printing the same here. Okay. Now we need to use this particular path to connect the database in our H2 console. Refresh it. Just to paste it, connect. When you look at customer table, whatever customer attribute available here, those attributes you can see as a column here. ID, address, fee, name, total. See, ID, address, fee, name, and total. Everything is here. Okay, now we want to perform a CRUD operation. When you use array list, I am using this class. Okay, this is already a backup. Okay, I'll go to rename it. Okay. If you want to perform any CRUD operation, we have to use repository classes. You don't have to mention service. Then this class must be interface. Then customer repository, whatever CRUD operation we're going to do. CRUD meaning, everybody know about the CRUD, right? CRUD meaning create, read, update, and delete. Okay, I want to perform this operation. Okay, for that, we need to create one repository class. Since I want to perform a CRUD operation customer, I am saying here public interface customer repository. Then extend JPA repository. Here we need to pass in what object you want to perform a CRUD operation. I want to perform customer object, comma, then primary key value, integer. Primary key is an integer type, right? So we have to say integer. That's it. Then I want to remove all this code. I don't want to write any single line of code to perform a CRUD operation. That is the beauty of JPA. Okay, that is the use of JPA. This answer for Deepan. Okay, so for do some CRUD operation, basic CRUD operation, we don't have to write any special method. Just we have to say public interface customer repository, whatever entity object you want to perform the CRUD operation. For that entity, we need to give a name. That is a according to that entity object, we have to provide a repository name. That is a customer repository. Extend JPA repository. JPA repository is coming from JPA API. Here we have to say, here the first argument you have to say, which object you want to perform CRUD operation. I want to perform customer object. So I'm saying here customer. Then it's a primary key type is an integer. So I'm saying here integer. That's it. Okay. Then go to service class. In the service class, already I auto-wired. We have to auto-wire this particular repository class. I already auto-wired it. Okay. Then I want to, if you want to perform a save or update operation, the service class I already made a method called save method. Then this customer repository class, from the customer repository class, we need to call one method called save method. Okay. When you look at here save method, it's coming from CRUD repository. Class. Okay. So I'm utilizing that method to perform a save. When you look at customer repository, extend JPA repository, when you click this JPA repository, extend from paging and the sorting repository. When you click this paging and the sorting repository, it is coming from, this is extending from CRUD repository. Okay, we can see here three classes. One is CRUD repository, then paging and the sorting repository, then JPA repository. In our program, I'm using JPA repository. JPA repository is contain having some advanced saving operation. JPA repository contains some advanced saving operation, CRUD operations methods. Paging and sorting repository for, if you want to paginate your DB rows, your database, you have thousands of rows, you have lakhs of rows. I want to paging and sorting those rows. In such a case, you can go with paging and sorting repository. Then if you want to perform only basic CRUD operation, I want to do some basic CRUD operation, save, delete, update. So this, if you want to perform that basic CRUD operation, we can use CRUD repository. Okay, this is the difference between three repository. CRUD repository, parent class, paging and shorting repository, child class of crude repository. JPA repository is a child class of paging and crude repository. I am using this one. Okay. If you want to perform only basic crude operation, we have to use crude repository. I can tell here like this. I can tell like this. If you do like this, I can perform only basic crude operation. If you want to perform paging and shorting mechanism, we need to use paging and shorting repository. Okay. Now this JPA repository having some advanced crude operation. Apart from that, we can utilize whatever method available inside this repository class. So I am using JPA repository. Okay, if you do that, through this customer repository, I can access all the methods to perform crude operation. Okay. In the service class, the customer service class, I am auto-wired customer repository and customer repository. I am auto-wired customer repository object. Then that customer repository object I am using in serve method of service class. Here I am saying customer repository.serve. I am calling this method from JP repository. In the serve method, we need to pass what type of entity you want to pass. I want to pass customer. And just I am passing customer, this serve method automatically serve this data to the database. That's it. It's a very simple. Okay. Yesterday for dummy crude operation, I did a lot of logic, right? Here we are not writing any single line. Everything taken care by JPA repository. Once saved, after saving, that will return a new customer object. That customer object I am returning by the serve method. By the serve method, in the customer controller, I'm auto wiring customer service. Instead of add customer, I am calling customer service.save. I am passing customer object. This customer object coming from client side as a request body. Just I am passing the customer object to the serve method. This serve method pass this customer object to my customer repository.serve method. This serve method will serve this customer data to the in our database. Okay. Then like the find get all customer. The crude repository having a find all method. This will return all the data which is available at the customer table. Here, get customer by ID. Return customer repository dot find by ID of I am passing customer ID. This will return customer object in the option in the form of optional class. If you see here, find by ID that will return optional of customer. Okay, we have to say like this here, dot or else, that is if customer object, this find by ID return customer object, I want to take that, otherwise I want to perform some operation. Let's say we don't find the customer for this ID, that time it will return null, right? So I want to say simply null. I don't want to throw any error. If this method return error, I want to say null. That's it. Find by ID return customer object. Find by ID return customer object. Then delete. Customer repository dot delete by ID. Delete by ID. If you say delete by ID, this is also coming from a JP repository class. Delete by ID, we have to pass customer ID. When you pass customer ID, this delete by ID delete the corresponding record from the database. Okay. Any questions so far here?
No worries.
So here I am doing 1, 2, 3, 4. Four method is available. Through this four method, I am performing the crude operation. When you see this method, I don't have any additional code. I don't have any my own code, right? Everything is taken care by JPA repository. That is the beauty of JPA. Okay.
Sir, this is Vaithi, sir. I'm having one doubt here. If you want to import multiple record, for example, if you want to import a list of customers from that CSV file or some other, is there any other method to provide a bulk insert from JPA repository? Else yeah. We have to do in a core.
Yeah, we have that. Yeah, that's what I said, right? Here, CRUD repository provide basic CRUD operation. Paging and sorting repository provide, if you want paging and sorting the data. JPEG repository provides some advanced method. If you want to insert, data as a batch, that time you can go with JPEG repository. Okay.
Okay.
So, Suresh,
save all.
Okay.
JPEG repository having one save all method. Yeah, tell me.
So yesterday we were saying that we built all our we written all our logic in customer repository.
Yeah.
So all those logics will be taken care by the JP repository.
That's it. Yeah.
And if you want to say, for example, if you're inserting some data, right, and if the data already exists in the database, so those kind of validation we need to handle it somewhere, or it no, will
no,
be again.
No need to handle. No need to handle that also. Okay. No need to handle. If it is already there, it will update the data. It don't insert.
Okay.
So your customer service at Java. I'm see when you pass the customer. If it is already the data is available. Obviously we are going to send that ID, right? Without ID, you are not sending. So through that, it's assume that it's already available. It will update. It won't insert. Taken care. Everything taken care by JP only.
Okay.
Now we're going to see this demo. I want to add a customer now. It's loading. Now I want to add a customer. So I'm using post method with this URL. When you call this URL, it will invoke this method. Okay. Suresh Kumar test street 1 2000. I'm going to pass to this. Send. See, it's created. I'm getting a response. How I'm getting a response here? When you see save method, so customer repository dot save. After successful save, the save method return the new customer object. That customer object returning to back to the controller, that from the controller, I'm returning that data to the client. That data printing here. The data is printing here. Okay. Now I'm going to check the database.
Every time you restart it, data will be wiped off.
Yes, sure. Correct. Exactly. Data will go and gone. This is only for development purpose. Data is populated here. Now I'm going to store few more data. Okay. So three data is, you can see here. Now I want to retrieve all the data. Get method. We were able to retrieve all the data. Okay. Then I want to retrieve only one data. See here. Retrieve one data. Now I want to delete. I want to update this data. I'm going to copy this entire request, paste it in request body. Then I'll going to say third equal to fourth street. Okay, then send a request. See here, Chiranjeevi is third street, right? You can see a fourth street modifier. Now I want to delete the second record. What is second record? Two. Then delete mapping, send. If you see here, you can see only two records. Okay. So Doing a DB manipulation is very easy in the case of a Spring Boot, okay, because the JP, most of the task taken care by JP itself, okay. Now next topic is we're going to see validation framework. Before sending a data to the server, I want to validate. I want to do some basic validation. Customer entered proper value or not. I want to check some basic validation. Okay, this validation we can achieve very easily in Spring Boot. Spring Boot provide one framework called Spring Boot Validation Framework. Using Spring Boot Validation Framework, we can achieve Spring Boot validation very easily. Okay, we'll see that now. I'll go to take my building system as a reference, because I forgot the class name. One class name. If you want to do a validation framework, we need to add one artifact. Okay, we need to add one artifact. That artifact is, yeah, this is the artifact we need to add. Without adding this artifact, we cannot do validation. We cannot use the Spring Boot validation. Okay, I'll going to copy this in our form.xml file. Then Maven reload project. Once this is the first step. If you want to perform validation, the first step, you need to add the validation framework artifact. The second step is we need to create a one class. Okay. I'll go to create a one package here. New package. I'm saying exception. Okay. I'm creating one class here. My validation. This class must extend from this class. Response entity exception handler. If you want to perform validation, we have to create one class. That class must extend from response entity exception handler. Using this class, we can do validation as well as exception handling. We can do validation as well as exception handling. Okay, two things we can do. Now we're going to see how to do the validation. Then after I created this class must annotated with controller advice. There is a one annotation called controller advice. We need to annotate with controller advice. Okay. These are the rules we need to follow. First, we need to add the artifact. Second, we created one class that extends from response entity exception handler. Then that class annotated with @controller advice. Then we need to override one method here. Right click, generate override method. In the override method, there is a one method called handle method argument valid. Handle method argument valid. Click OK. Okay, we have to override this method. We have to provide our own logic here. Okay. Okay, now make it returnal to avoid the error. Okay. So this is the way to this is the steps to need to follow to implement the validation framework. Okay. Then go to controller. Whenever add a new customer, I want to validate this customer object. Whatever attribute available here I have a name attribute, here I have address attribute. Let's say I want to validate client entered valid name. If client entered empty value, I don't want to proceed. I want to throw error. If client entered an empty value in address attribute, I don't want to proceed. I want to throw the error to the client side. I want to do this. So these two attributes available in the customer object. This object act as a request body in the add customer. Okay. Now, if you want to validate these attributes, we need to use one annotation called @valid. Okay. If you say @valid, whenever you send the data through this customer, through this annotation, it will validate these two attributes. How it validate? How do you know that @valid annotation? No, we need to validate this name and address. For that, we need to use one more annotation called @notempty. @notempty. Then @notempty value message equal to customer name cannot be empty. Then here customer address cannot be empty. Okay. Now in this annotation, in this attribute, I added one annotation called @notempty. This is the field level annotation. Using this annotation, we can validate the particular attribute. If it is not a valid, we can print this message in the customer side. In the customer side, we can print this message. Now next step is we need to check how to print this message. For that, we need to write some program. We need to write some logic. That logic must be available here. We have to write here. That logic we have to write here. Okay. Just I'll going to copy this code. Paste it here. In the line number 22, I'm saying here binding result equal to arguments dot get binding results. That is method argument not valid exception. I'm saying method argument here. There is a one parameter method argument not valid exception. This particular exception class holds whatever value not entered by the user. For example, if the customer the client not entering name and address attribute, that validation message detail available inside this exception object, inside this exception object, that message available in the binding result, this particular object contain user defined message as well as spring specific messages also. Everything is available here only. Okay, now I want to extract only whatever message I passed in the annotation. I want to extract only that message. Okay, this I'm going to keep it top. I'll tell that. Okay. Through this method, I taken all the error data here. Then from this binding result object, there is one method called get all errors. This get all errors return a list object. That list object having one class called object error. For example, in the client side, I am not entering syringe name and address. If you are not entering name and address, this will return two errors. If you not enter these two attributes, this will return two errors. That error information I am assigning to this object errors. I am iterating here. While iterating, I am getting current object error object. From that object error, I am saying get default message. If you say get default message, this message will return. Okay. This message will return assigned to the string object. This default message contains this data, right? I want to store that data inside a list. Here I am creating my own array list. In that array list, I am adding that message. Now, if user not entering two data, two times this for loop get execute, Each time it will give a one message. That message I am adding into validation message array list. Okay. Then finally I am saying return new response entity. Return new response entity. Return new response entity. Then validation message. Whatever I am passing validation message, this array list here. Second argument I am passing bad request. I am sending the proper error code. That is a bad request. Whatever you entered is a bad, I am saying. That is a bad request on status. Its a status is a 404. Okay. I am sending this message as a response to the client through return new response entity. Using this response entity class, we can send a message as well as status. If you want to send a message as well as status, we need to use one class called response entity. Using response entity, the first argument, we need to tell what message you want to pass. The second argument, you need to tell what is the status of that particular call. The status is a bad request. Okay. Whenever say like this, this message will print in client side. This message will print in client side. Now I'm going to show the demo. Before that, I will going to explain one more time. Now assume that I am not entering this too well. I am not entering too well. Okay. Through at valid annotation, it start validating. Okay, start validating. Since customer object, this value get populated in customer object. Customer object. This customer object does not have a two value. That is name and address does not have any value. It's a empty. It's a empty. Once it's a empty, automatically what will happen? It will go to this class. The Spring framework will do automatically. One, that particular field is a empty, Spring would automatically go to this validation class, invoke this method. Then whatever value not entered the particular attribute, that attribute information populated here. The attribute information populated here. That is, I am not entering customer name and address. That data will be populated here. Now I want to take that data. I want to print it. Argument dot get binding itself return that error data. From this binding result, I am taking only errors. Get all errors. Get all error means since I am not passing two attributes, that two error come here. I am iterating this in the for loop. Each iteration, I am taking the default message. The default message nothing but whatever message you passed in that annotation, not empty annotation. That message will come. That message I am adding it to the in my array list. After adding it, that array list I am sending as a response through response entity object. Response through response entity, we can send a message along with we can send a status. I am saying it's a bad request, and I am saying here you are not entering so and so value. I start the application now. Application started. Now I'm going to send a I want to store some data, customers, then send. So here we are getting the error. The customer address cannot be empty. The customer name cannot be empty. At the time of sending request through this valid annotation, we are validating the customer data. If anything empty, it will go to this class. Springboard go to this class and invoke this method. Invoke this method. Once this method get invoked, whatever logic we have written, that logic get execute. Here we can write our own logic. Here this is my own logic. This logic get execute. Then finally I am collecting the all the errors. This error message I'm sending as a response entity. Along with the response entity, I'm sending bad request. This message and a bad request will come. When you look at the postman, you can see a bad request. So this is the way of handling the validations in the Spring Boot. See, here you can see one advantages. Here I am validating the customer object, right? Here I am validating customer object. Now tomorrow we're going to create a one more controller class. It's a product controller. I want to add some product data. At the time of adding the product data, I want to validate the product attribute. What you have to do in that controller method, you need to add atValid. Then that product object, wherever you need, you need to add this annotation. This kind of annotation you tab. Once you're done, that's it. You don't have to do anything. Whenever an empty field find, automatically this method will invoke for your product controller also. This is a generic method applicable for whatever controller you are writing. This method is applicable for all the methods, all the controllers. Okay. You don't have to write validation for each and every method. Any question? You understand this part? How the error is getting populated?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
Suresh, I have one doubt. Yes. Here we are validating only the not null values, right? Yeah. So I wanted to validate the pattern.
Yes,
for example, there are
lot of libraries available. Not sure. Okay, see here.
Okay, where we can get it, those libraries?
I will check here. Data and the start. See here, Spring Boot starter validation.
Okay.
Here you can see some libraries. If you want, I will collect that, give you all the tags. Okay, from this you can. There are many annotations available. I will give you the list. Okay. You can just you can simply you can add, and then you can add appropriate argument. That's it.
That's it.
For example, I will going to add one more thing. At min. Value equal to 100, I am saying. If you do like this, right, you have to enter minimum 100 value. Okay, you cannot enter less than that. So there are many annotations available. I will share that tomorrow.
Yeah, thank you.
Then next one is we have to see exception handling. Okay. We need to use the same class. For exception handling, we need to use the same class. Then here we have to create a multiple methods. The each method handle particular exception. What is the time now? It's there. 8:40. Okay. Till 20 minutes there. Okay, we'll do. We'll see. See here, get method API customer slash one. I'm saying get send, but one the data is available. The DB, we don't have any data, right? But it's saying success 200. Okay, our REST endpoint is working fine, but it's not a proper, right? We are not handling properly. If it is not if there is no data, we need to give proper error message. The particular resource is not found, we have to say. I am saying instead of that, I am saying success. That is not correct. It's a bad. Okay, we need to handle this kind of situation properly through exception handling. Okay. Here I'm going to create a one class, exception class, the class name is resource not found exception. Then extend exception. Then I'm creating a constructor here, public resource not found exception string error message. String error message, then super off. I am passing this error message in a parent class. That's it. It's a very simple exception class I created here, resource not found exception. Whenever you find a resource, not only customer, in my application, in across my application, whenever you find any kind of resource, if that resource is not found, I want to throw this exception. I want to throw this exception. Okay. Let's see how to do that. I'll go to building exception. I'll take that method. Actually, this building project is very good for you. If you want to do anything in your project, most of the examples available here. You can take that, you can use it. Then I'll go to the my validation. Just paste it here. Here I created one method called resource not found method. Resource not found method. Then there is a two arguments. One is a resource not found exception web request. These are very, very important argument. Okay. Resource not found exception. This method annotated with one annotation called exception handler. This method annotated with one annotation called exception handler. In that annotation, I am passing resource not found exception, which I created. I'm annotating resource not found exception. Meaning of this line is, wherever application throwing resource not found exception, I want to execute this method. Not only customer place, wherever you're trying to search any resource in your project, if the resource is not found, that particular resource is not found, I want to invoke this method. For that, I'm saying at the exception handler, then resource not found exception dot class. Okay. Then inside this method, resource not found, I am saying here, first argument passing resource not found exception. For example, go to controller class, go to service class. Go to get customer by ID. Here I am saying customer property dot find by ID. I am saying, okay, if customer not equal to null, sorry, equal to null, then I want to throw new resource not found exception. The customer is not found from the ID plus customer ID.
So this, can we give it in the DARELS condition instead of this one?
Yeah, we can do that. Yeah. If customer equal to undulled exception, then throws exception. We can do that, Dipan. If it is null, come to here, throw in the exception. If it is not null, directly return this. Okay. Go to customer controller. Since I am handling throwing the exception, you have to say like this, throw exception. That's it. Now, here, if it is customer is equal to null, customer is null, I am throw new resource not found exception. At the time of throwing resource not found exception, your Spring Boot application come to here, any method implemented for this resource not found exception, it will call that method. Yes, we have implemented one method, resource not found method, that method for resource not found exception. Whenever throw this exception, our Spring Boot validation framework come to this my validation class, check that any method annotated with resource not found exception class, that respective method get called. Then now this resource not found exception having this message, right? This message, that message binded here, binded this resource not found exception object. Whatever exception throwing, that exception instance available here. From here, I can take the message. This message return this data. This method, that message return this data. Whatever message I am passing here, this message available through this get message. Okay. In your application, wherever you're throwing the exception, if that exception handled here, that exception reference come here. Through that object, I can take that the respective message. I am throwing that message as a response entity saying status called not found. Through response entity, I am sending this message as a response to the client. Then I am saying the status called not found. Okay. Now I'm going to check whether it's working or not. Server is started now. Then going to send this. The request body is not required here. Okay. That is, if you use get method, it never use that request body. The customer is not found for the ID 1. It's throwing now. Because the one customer is not available. Then it's saying not found. 404 not found. Whenever you throw particular exception, here we are throwing the resource not found exception. If this method handled in your validation class, that method get invoked, then the first argument, whatever exception you are throwing, this exception I'm throwing, that particular instance available inside this object. From this object, I am taking the current message. I am throwing that message as a response to the client along with some error status. Here I am sending as a not found. Okay. Fine. We'll see tomorrow. We're going to see how to send this error properly. How to send? Here I am sending only one message, right? I want to design error data. I want to design error data in such a manner. Whenever error is coming, I want to throw that error to the client side. Like when this error happened, then what is the error code, then error message. I want to design some error data, error object. I want to design some error object. I want to send that error object to the client side as a response instead of sending a simple string. Okay.
Sir, one basic doubt, sir.
Yeah, tell me, Sanjeev.
You know, can you open the service layer once again? Here in the line number 29, we have thrown you are throwing, right, sir?
Yes,
and 26 line number, that throws exception is mandatory or optional?
This mandatory.
Mandatory, sir?
Mandatory, okay. Yeah. This mandatory. Remove it. Let's see. See here.
Yes,
we have to add that. Okay.
Okay.
Are you guys practicing whatever I teaching? If you are not practicing, definitely will forget. If you try in your daytime, if you have any problem, let me know. Okay.
Sure, sir. Suresh, I'll try it out today, Suresh. I mean, I'll try from scratch, start creating a Spring project.
Okay.
And if I have any issue, I'll let you.
Yeah, please call me.
Yeah.
This is for everybody, sure. Okay? If you have an issue, please let me know. I'll fix it. Okay, thank you guys. Still not subscribe this channel, please subscribe it, share this video to your friend circle, click bell icon for regular updates. Thanks for watching this full video.